which we are streaming the webinar, but at the same time having a physical session after the lockdown took place, and this is taking place in Trust Square in the center of Zurich. Please raise your hand or let me know, okay? Tiziano, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. First, let me thank Claudio for the invitation of giving this lecture in the series of the Blockchain Center lecture series about cryptocurrencies. So let me, in order to share my screen, I must be enabled. So this is maybe a technical issue.
I am not the host, yeah. So the host will be able to do that.
As soon as you enable me, I will start sharing the screen.
They raised the travel tickets.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, so I think now you can see my screen, right? Yeah. Okay, so the topic I'm going to talk about is a series of results about the study of cryptocurrencies, and in particular of Bitcoin, which is a topic that, as Claudio was mentioning before, I started to investigate quite recently together with Claudio himself. So this presentation is actually an overview of results of a network approach to the analysis of cryptocurrencies. And of course, these results have been obtained thanks to the collaboration of with other gentlemen that I would like to thank and to mention all, and who are represented here. And these guys are Kevin, Carlo, Valerio, Claudio, of course, Alex, Niccolò, Francesco, Christian, and Jean Hong. So thanks to them for contributing to obtain these results. Now, we have decided to apply network theory to the study of these systems because network theory has been proven to be quite successful in the description of several real-world systems, or different classes, actually, of real-world systems, like the most traditional ones, which are the natural systems, ecological networks, biological networks, and so on, but also to less traditional systems of interest for physics, like socioeconomic systems. However, I have to say that one of the most successful application of network theory has been to the study of financial systems. I'm thinking of interbank network, for example, so quite a standard, if you want, financial systems. And I'm thinking of the research line of network reconstruction or detection of early warning signals. However, quite recently, it has been applied also to less standard financial systems like cryptocurrencies. And this is where we have joined the stream of literature. So I must say that there exist several contributions of the application of network theory to cryptocurrencies, but all these contributions are somehow limited. Let's say that they provide a quite limited overview of the evolution of these systems because they usually focus on a very short period of time, like 2 years or 3 years. So it's really difficult to have a complete view of the evolution of these systems. So this is why, together with the Bitcoin team, the gentleman I was showing before, we decided to analyze Bitcoin and the Bitcoin Lightning Network from the very beginning, so throughout the entire history of these systems. So let's start with Bitcoin. Just to sum up the very beginning of it, Bitcoin is a cryptocurrency, which means that it's a blockchain-based system. So the architecture of the system is actually a chain, which is a sequence of blocks. And these blocks collect transactions. So each block is a bunch of transactions. Now, the idea behind the design of the blockchain is that the system should be completely decentralized. So there is no need of a central authority, of someone that checks the validity of the transactions and that allows them, that validate them. This is realized basically in a completely decentralized way via the so-called consensus algorithm. So there is the idea that because of the same design of the system, that the more or less all the users joining the system play the same role. This is not the case from a network theory point of view, and this will become more clear later on. But so the beginning of, so the structure, the hardware of the system is this blockchain. So how can we move to a network description of it? Well, the idea is that we need to find a plausible definition of a network out of the blockchain. Since we are dealing with a cryptocurrency, the most natural representation is the address network. So the nodes of the network are the addresses, and the links indicate transactions between them. So indicate exchanges of Bitcoins between them. Of course, we can decide to allow for a direction of these links or keep them undirected. If we allow for a direction, then we follow the flux of the Bitcoin. So the Bitcoin are transferred from address A to address J, following the direction of the arrow. On the other hand, if we decide to ignore it, a link just indicates the presence of an exchange. So this is the first representation, address network. However, it's also interesting to consider some more coarse-grained representation, which is the user network. Now, in order to define the user network, we need some kind of method to cluster addresses together. And these methods are called heuristics. The idea is that they are not exact in the mathematical sense. The idea of the heuristics is that they are based on regularities that can be exploited in order to say, okay, it's likely that this bunch of addresses belong to the same entity that we call user. So we have to exploit some of these regularities. For example, for the work that I'm going to talk about, we use the multi-input and the change address heuristics. Very briefly, the multi-input is based on the observation that if many addresses belong to the input, let's say of a transaction, they are likely to belong to the same user. And the same is valid for the change address. In case one is not able to transfer precisely the amount of the desired amount of Bitcoin, one needs to send to himself the change. So it's also likely that it belongs to the same user starting the transaction. So with these two heuristics, we are able to collect addresses together and to create a user network. Of course, the meaning of the links is the same as the meaning of the links in the address representation. Overall speaking, the user network is characterized by more regular trends, if I can say this, and this will become clearer in the follows. So let's start with the evolution of very basic statistics for Bitcoin, which are the total number of nodes, total number of links, and link density. So independently of the representation that is chosen, both address and user network, the total number of nodes, so the size of the system, is rising and has kept rising throughout the history, the entire history, I would say. The total number of links is also rising. But what's interesting is that the link density is decreasing. So this means that the system is becoming larger and larger, but it's becoming sparser. So it's becoming more empty, because the link density measures the percentage of links that are realized out of the total possible one. So if it's decreasing, it's becoming more and more empty. Now, the mathematical function that describes the decreasing of the density is really nice. Let's say that this decrease follows quite precisely a mathematical function. And this is the inverse of the total number of nodes. So the link density goes like 1/n. Why this? Well, because if you explicitly write the expression of the link density, which is L/n², you see that there appears the ratio of L/n, so the total number of connection divided by the total number of users. And this is nothing else than the average degree. So it's the average number of connections per node. And if you see the picture here, the average number of connections per node is basically constant for what concerns the user network. So the black and the blue trends are basically flat for the entire Bitcoin history. So in the mathematical expression, that is a constant, and what matters is 1/n. So the decreasing I was showing before. For what concerns the address network, the average degree is bounded, is not constant. You see that the red and yellow trend are quite noisy. This is a common characteristic of the address network. So the trend are less regular, but still they are bounded. So they remain between 1 and 10. So the decrease in the link density of the address network also follows the 1/n mathematical relationship. Okay, so the fact that on average each node contributes with one or two links maximum, this is given by the average degree here, of course is a very general description because it's just the average. So in order to gain more detailed information on the nodes, we can plot the degree distribution. This is the degree distribution of the user network for Bitcoin in two different moments of its history. The first row here, the first three plots, refer to a moment in time which is before the failure of Mt. Gox. So before the failure of the famous market exchange. On the other hand, the second row of plot refers to the a moment in time which is after the failure of Mt. Gox. There is a difference in these two degree distributions. The difference is the following: that before the failure of Mt. Gox, in half of the cases you can talk of a power law. So a statistical test, which is the Kolmogorov-Smirnov test, tells you that you can allow for, I mean, you can accept the description of this distribution as a power law in the half of the cases. After the failure of Mt. Gox, the number of times you can speak of a power law reduces to 1/4. So only a quarter of the cases. Of course, this is not so important. I mean, the precise description of this degree distribution. What matters is that it's a fat tail, right tail degree distribution, which means that there are many, many nodes with just one or two links, very few connections, and few nodes that play the role of the hubs, which are very central, let's say, so are connected to many, many other nodes in the network. Okay, so this is the one of the features of Bitcoin at the macro scale. So at the level of the single nodes. Of course, one can say something more having the evidence of this fat-tailedness of the degree distribution. One can imagine a dynamical process of growth of Bitcoin that must be very similar to the preferential attachment. If these degree distribution are similar to power laws, then there is some dynamics which is very similar to the one leading to the one described by the preferential attachment. So each new node joining the system preferentially connects to a hub, to a node with a very large number of connections. And this is how these very peculiar degree distributions emerge. So we have also an indirect hint about the dynamic evolution of Bitcoin. Okay, so let's move to the mesoscale and let's inspect the degree correlations between nodes in Bitcoin. In network theory, there is a quantity that describes degree correlations, which is the assortativity. Assortativity means that similar nodes are connected together, which means that the degree correlations are positive. So nodes with a low degree are connected to nodes with a low degree. Nodes with high degree are connected to nodes with high degree. On the other hand, if the network is disassortative, the degree correlations are negative. Nodes with low degree are connected to nodes with large degree and vice versa. Now, having in mind the preferential attachment mechanism, it's easy to imagine that Bitcoin is disassortative. In a very simplified way, we can say that around the a hub, one can think of a star-like structure. So there is the hub like behaving like a center, and all the leaves that play the role of the nodes with one maximum two connections. So the network is disassortative, and you can see this by plotting the average nearest neighbor degree versus the degree of the nodes. And the red dots are precisely this. So the decreasing trend of this red cloud tells you that the network is disassortative. So there will be many nodes with connected to there will be a few nodes with large degree connected to many nodes with a low degree. Now, in order to understand how significant is this result, we have compared the empirical cloud of the KNN, average nearest neighbor degree, with the prediction of a null model. And the prediction is the blue trend. Now, the model predicts a network which is less disassortative than expected. So this model that I'm going to describe predicts Bitcoin as having less negative correlations than observed. So the Bitcoin is a really disassortative, more than expected disassortative network. In network theory, in order to be able to assess these kind of properties, you have to compare the observed quantity, like degree correlation, with a benchmark. The benchmark that we have chosen here is the configuration model. And basically, what does the configuration model? It randomizes the network, preserving only the degrees. And the idea is, okay, so if I just preserve the degrees, are the degree correlation destroyed or not? If they are destroyed, this means that the knowledge, the relevant knowledge of the network is encoded into the degrees. Otherwise, if they are not destroyed, this means that there is something more to know in order to reproduce the features of the network. So the degree sequence is not enough. And this is precisely the case of Bitcoin. The prediction of the theoretical model, which is solely based on the degree sequence, is not enough to reproduce the disassortative character of the network. Okay, so this is the still the mesoscale structure of Bitcoin. And now here we focus on the global connectivity of the network. So the first plot shows that almost 90% of the nodes connecting constituting Bitcoin are connected together. So there is a large connected component. But this is not the, and this, I mean, this this number is quite stable across the entire history of Bitcoin. But this is not the only interesting feature, because this component is calculated by ignoring the direction of the links. So overall, nodes are connected, irrespectively of the arrows that link any two nodes. But if we keep the arrows, we obtain the plot that is in the second row. And the plot in the second row shows that the 30% almost of the nodes belong to a strongly connected component. So Bitcoin at the mesoscale have a very rich structure, and the strongly connected component is basically a set of nodes. And starting from each of these nodes, you can reach all the other one in the strongly connected component by following the arrows. So it's a really peculiar structure. And you see that this strongly connected component basically is established around 2013 and keeps the same size until 2016. So for 3 years, we have this core with the 30% of nodes. Notice that the failure of empty gox didn't affect the size of the strongly connected component, but since 2016 on, these seem to be reduced. So this is the pictorial representation of the weakly connectedness, strongly connectedness, and disconnectedness. Okay, so the 30% of nodes are strongly connected component. What about the remaining one? The remaining network constitute what is called in network theory a bow tie structure. In particular, the 30% of nodes is still in the SCC component, there in the center of the picture, and the remaining part of the nodes constitute the in and the out component. Now, the presence of a bow tie structure is somehow an indication that there is a flow in the network. So if you start from the in component and you follow the arrows, you arrive to the strongly connected component. If you are in the strongly connected component, either you remain inside or you go out and you reach all the nodes in the out component. This is the idea of the bow tie, and this characterizes Bitcoin. In particular, the strongly connected component, which amounts at 30% of nodes, remains there for 3 years, 2013, 2016. In the same period, you see in the plot in the second row that there is an in and an out component, which are whose size is less than the strongly connected component. But after 2016, the strongly connected component decreases, and what rises is the in component. So in this portion, you see that basically at the end of the history of Bitcoin, the in component becomes very large, and the strongly connected component and the out component becomes very small. This is how, I mean, this is the way Bitcoin is evolving. Beside other features that characterize the bow tie structure and which are less important. Okay, so this is more or less a general description of Bitcoin. At least, I mean, the results that we have obtained so far, still matter of investigation. What's also interesting to us, or in general for financial networks, is to understand the relationship between the evolution of topological properties and the evolution of purely financial indicators. In this case, the most important financial indicator is the price. So the idea is, are there correlations between the evolution of the total number of nodes, for example, and the price? The answer is yes. And this is relevant in financial networks because in focusing on the topology can allow you even to anticipate movements in the price. This is something that we inspect, for example, when searching for early warning signals of events like the crisis. So the topology is very indicative of what's going on, of what's coming next. So it's very meaningful to always compare the evolution of purely structural quantities with purely financial quantities, because typically there is interesting information also in the former one. In this case, we see that overall, the total number of nodes rises, but there are local movements. So locally, the number of nodes can also decrease. When the total number of nodes decrease, the price decrease in turn. We have inspected this with the RPMA, which is the rolling price moving average. So basically we compare the price at time t with the average price with calculated in a window just before time t. So it's interesting that there is this correlation. This correlation is valid until 2014, so before the failure of MTGOX. Since 2014 until 2016, if I remember correctly, the price continuously decreases, the number of nodes increases, so this correlation is lost, and this correlation is recovered only after 2016. You can also see this more clearly if you plot the price versus the total number of nodes, and you see that there is basically a linear relationship in a log-log scale. Of course, this linear relationship is interrupted in correspondence of the failure of MTGOX, so when there is this dashed line, gray dashed line, and just after it, you see that the linear trend somehow has an inversion, which is the broken correlation between price rising and total number of nodes rising. But let's say that in general, correlations are there, and it's really interesting and meaningful to inspect them. Okay, I think we can move to the Bitcoin Lightning Network. And the idea of the Bitcoin Lightning Network is that of solving, let's say, the scalability issue of Bitcoin. The rate at which Bitcoin, at which transactions are processed is not that satisfactory. So the idea is that of not burdening the blockchain so much. So the idea is that of creating a second layer where the user joining the second layer can do faster payments, let's say. In order to do these faster payments, they have to choose a pattern, to individuate a pattern in the network that join them. This is the basic idea of the Bitcoin Lightning Network. We have repeated basically the same analysis that we did on Bitcoin. And what we observed is that even for the Bitcoin Lightning Network, the total number of nodes and the total number of links rises. The link density decreases, even if here we can speak of two different phases, if you want. So in the first months of life of the Bitcoin Lightning Network, N and L were rising really steeply. After this period, the growth of nodes and links is much slower. And also the link density decreases less steeply. However, in the first month of life of the BLN, the same law is recovered, which is the density goes like 1/n, which is interesting. I mean, it's a similarity between the two layers. But what's also very interesting, it's the analysis of centrality, as Claudio was mentioning. So in network, the study of centrality amounts at understanding if there are nodes that play a more important role than others. Now, this in some sense, the answer to the question, are there nodes more important than others? In principle should be no, because the system is decentralized. However, if you analyze the centrality, you find something which is quite different. So the centrality measures that we have considered are the ones that I'm showing here, are the most popular centrality measures, and they are the degree centrality, so the number of connections of each node, the closeness centrality, so the topological distance from one node to another, so the number of links that you have to walk to reach the other node, the betweenness centrality, which is the number of patterns that cross a given node, and the eigenvector centrality. The eigenvector centrality is very similar to the page rank. So a node with a large eigenvector centrality is connected to other well-connected nodes. in a sense, nodes with a large eigenvector centrality are likely to constitute a core of the network because they are well connected and also connected between them. Okay, so to understand how centrality is distributed, we use the Gini coefficient. The Gini coefficient is a very compact measure, just a number that ranges between 0 and 1. If it's 0, there is perfect evenness in the distribution. All the numbers are the same. If it's 1, there is maximum unevenness. For example, if you analyze the richness of countries, you find that in the extreme case, there is one guy having all the money and all the other guys having zero money. But this is too extreme for the Bitcoin Lightning Network. What we see by plotting the evolution of the Gini coefficient is that for 3 measures of centrality out of 4, so for degree, betweenness, and eigenvector centrality, the Gini coefficient rises. So, and reaches quite large values at the end of the history of the Bitcoin Lightning Network, like 0.8 for the degree centrality. So this means that the unevenness of the distribution of centrality has risen. There are nodes which are more important than others. And this is true for these 3 indicators. For what concerns the closeness centrality, the flat trend is not in contradiction with the other trends, but I will show you this in a while. So the idea is that as the Bitcoin Lightning Network evolves, hubs appear. Nodes with a larger number of connections, with a larger betweenness, appear. Okay, now, in order to be even more precise, we decided to also calculate the so-called centralization. The centralization is a number that tells you how similar a network is to a star graph. The idea is that the most central network structure is precisely a star because you have a single center and all the nodes connected to it. So the center is also the node with the maximum number of connections, which is closer to all the other one that is crossed by all the path and so on. So the idea is, how similar is this network to a star? This is the explicit calculation of the centralization. And if you look at the evolution of centralization, you see that the Bitcoin Lightning Network is not becoming similar to a star. Why? Well, because the centralization has a maximum value of 1 and it is never reached. I mean, the degree oscillates around 0.2, 0.3. Of course, there are moments in the history where the value goes like 0.8. But then in the most recent times, is not that high. So how can we reconcile the picture of the Gini coefficient that tells you that there are hubs with the picture provided by the centralization? I'm coming to this in a while. Well, the idea is that there is a core. There is a core in the Bitcoin Lightning Network. So there is a bunch of nodes, very, very well connected, that constitute a very central portion of the network. So the Bitcoin Lightning Network is not evolving towards a star graph, but towards a generalization of the star graph, which is the core periphery structure. Okay, so we repeated the exercise that we did for the assortativity in the Bitcoin network. And we see that the results on the centrality and on the centralization are statistically significant. So even for the Bitcoin Lightning Network, if you try to reproduce the Gini coefficient and the centralization just by enforcing the degrees, you are not able to do this. So there is a tendency of the system going beyond the degrees to become more central. And this is visible in this plot because the empirical pattern are the blue one and the patterns predicted by a model are the red one. So the blue one are have a larger value than the red one. So there is a positive tendency of the system to become more central. Okay, so this is the picture I wanted to show. This is quite clear if you visualize the Bitcoin Lightning Network. This is taken into different snapshots of its history. And if you draw the nodes according to the value of degree centrality or any other centrality measures, you realize that indeed there are hubs, as the Gini coefficient was telling you. The network is not similar to a star, but there are many centers. So the hubs are the centers of star-like structures. In a sense, the Bitcoin Lightning Network is composed by many stars, and these hubs are connected between them. If you now plot the closeness centrality, you see that more or less all the nodes have the same value of the closeness centrality. And this is intuitive because there is not much difference between the closeness of a hub and the closeness of any of the nodes connected to it. The difference is just one. So this is why the trend of the closeness centrality is flat. For the betweenness centrality, you still recover the presence of the hubs. So the nodes crossed by many, many patterns. And if you now calculate the eigenvector centrality, you see that there is this core of well-connected nodes. So the intuition is that the Bitcoin Lightning Network is not becoming a star, as I said, but it's becoming a core periphery structure. And in order to be even more sure about this, we explicitly searched for the Bitcoin, for the core periphery division of the network. So we explicitly search for the best partition, the most significant partition of the network. And what we found is that, let's say, it's not community, it's not the traditional community partition, but it's the core periphery one. We did this by optimizing a score function, which is called surprise. The surprise was originally introduced for community detection, but has been extended for core periphery detection. And so basically by optimizing it, we found the presence of a core and of a periphery. The core nodes are colored in brown and the periphery nodes are colored in green. What's interesting about surprise is that it's a p-value. So you can attach a statistical significance to a partition. So you are sure that what you find is significant, is not the outcome of statistical noise. It's something that the system, let's say, wants to create. That's the interpretation that we need. So a core periphery structure is there. And what's interesting is that the nodes that constitute the core of the Bitcoin Lightning Network, which are on the right of your screen, overlap to a large extent to the nodes with a large eigenvector centrality. So actually, as we suspected at the beginning, the eigenvector centrality provides a quite precise hint of the presence of a core periphery structure. So this is the kind of centralization that we have in mind. It's not as extreme as the star case, but still there are nodes that play a very important structural role. There are nodes, there are hubs that are in a sense more important than others. What are the consequences of this? Or other interpretation of this that together with Claudio and the other guys we were trying to figure it out? Well, if you consider that the Bitcoin Lightning Network in a sense is subject to the choices of the users, they have to find a path. So why do very central nodes emerge? Well, in the weak sense, users tend to realize the cheaper possible transactions. So the path that they have to, that they will likely choose, won't be that long. Shorter paths are cheaper paths. So users are want to do this, to spend less fees. So they will likely find the shorter path, which likely will cross one of the most central nodes. On the other hand, there is a strong interpretation that users want to be central because they may gain from the fees of the transactions. So these two interpretations can shed light on the behavior of the users, but tell you why these central nodes are created. Because again, it's convenient. It's convenient from to pass through one of them. Okay. Of course, the presence of central nodes has also consequences on the resilience of the network. Because one of these, I'm going back, one of these hubs, if it's disconnected, will fragment the network. So we'll make many, many nodes, we'll make them isolated. And we have explicitly seen this by removing the hubs from the one with the largest degree and going down to the others with which are less central. And by removing them, calculating the number of components that are created. And you see that as the Bitcoin Lightning Network evolves in time, more and more components are left disconnected if you remove the hubs. And you see, because the purple trends here indicate the number of components that are left isolated, which just after removing five nodes in day 4 to 8, I mean, the number of components amount at 200. So there is also a resilience issue of the network. If one of these hubs fail, the network will fragment, will disconnect in many, many isolated components. There are also privacy issues because it's believed that longer path will guarantee more privacy because of course it's more difficult to individuate the starting and ending point of a path if it's longer. So there is also concern about this. And so the final message, let's say, of our findings of the Bitcoin Lightning Network is precisely this, that although the system is designed in such a way to get rid of a central authority, of a central entity, at the network level, centrality somehow is recovered. Is recovered because of the choices of the user, but there are nodes that are more important than others. And this has consequences on the privacy, on the resilience of the network, and so on. So this is the final picture that I found, and I found it quite interesting, that the Bitcoin Lightning Network is not as central as shown in the leftmost picture, but it's not even as distributed as people would like it to be, as in the rightmost picture. There are many centers. So it's most likely, it reminds of, it's most similar to the center picture. Of course, these are results that we have obtained, and the consequences of which are still to be investigated. But for the future perspective, we would like to extend them also to the first layer, so to the traditional Bitcoin, even if we have already seen that there is a core also there, which is a strongly connected component. So it's really interesting to see how network theory can reveal aspects of the system that in principle shouldn't be there. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Tiziano. The digital nature of this meeting does not allow you to finish with a knocking at the table as it would be customary. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I have a set of questions that appeared in the chat during your presentation, and I invite the participants, if you they want to make any other question, please let us know. The first question, I will go in order simply because of I will try to rearrange them. There is one regarding the two questions actually regarding the correlation between price and the number of nodes in the Bitcoin transaction network. Could you please go back there so that I make them in a more or less logical order? I think that in the next one, it's the correlation is between number exactly and price. And the first question is, what happens at the dotted line? Why is it that the correlation, why is it that the linear relationship between price and number of nodes is not applicable anymore? Does it have anything to do with the hype in 2017?
No, that's the empty Gox failure. So basically, we have explicitly draw the line in correspondence of the number of nodes that were in the network at the time of the empty Gox failure. And you see here for the Bitcoin price that the price basically decreases during the period 2014-2016. So it's just after the Bitcoin, the empty Gox failure, that the price decreases until 2016, and then it goes up again. So that trend inversion, here is somehow related to the empty Gox failure. Mm-hmm. At least that that line that designed the total number of nodes that were observed in the network at the moment of the failure.
Yeah. Just as a general comment, also because empty Gox was also a much more, let's say, all the economy, all the exchanges of Bitcoin with respect to fiat currencies, which were much more centralized before the demise of empty Gox with respect to what happened afterwards. That's why there is a structural change in a way. And Thorsten asked a question before that still has a very interesting second part, which is there a correlation between the number of nodes and price? And this is what you have been showing here. And the second part of his question is what happens with predictability, or whether one thing, there is a correlation, what happens with the predictability of one signal with respect to the other?
Actually, this is a very interesting question, and it's a current matter of investigation. For what I can say is that there seems to be a causal relationship also between the number of nodes and the price. We are still investigating it. It seems that at a certain point there is a loop, so there is a positive feedback between price rising, number of nodes, so people joining the system, price rising again. This is a Granger causality analysis, and this is the preliminary results that we have. I'm not
sure. Happy with the preliminary results. Let us be sure that the referees are two.
yes. So I don't know if I'm allowed to say more about this, but. There seem to be causal relationship. Mm-hmm. Yeah,
absolutely. I have a question that more or less links to the second part of your presentation and then to the rest of the questions that we have from the audience, which is, here you say that there is a very strong relationship between price and the number of nodes, but on the other hand, at the mesoscopic scale, you also showed that the mesoscale topology of the network did not change much exactly at that breaking point, isn't it?
Yes. Let me go here. Yes, let's say that overall, the connectedness of the network doesn't seem too much affected by the removal of one node. Let's say that an explanation can be that actually there are many of these hubs, many of these market exchanges that keep the network together. So even if you remove one of them, doesn't happen much. This is also true for the strongly connected component. What's interesting is that the size of the strongly connected component, so the core, decreases after 2016. So that's something interesting to be investigated. Because if you see in correspondence of 2016, there is a sharp decrease of the core of the network. So the number of nodes that can be reached by following the path decreases from 30% to almost 10%. So this needs to be investigated. What happened in 2016 that let the core reduce so much? From my experience in network theory, this can be also can be also a consequence of the removal of a very central node within the strongly connected component, which is not MTGOX, another market exchange maybe. If you remove one of them, then you may create a damage like this, let's say. But still, we need to investigate it.
Absolutely. The second, another question, sorry, that I have is, just to get a gut feeling of the nature of the results, Malik asks, from the centralization point of view, one thing that you show when you are showing the centralization indices for Lightning Network, the numbers oscillate between 0.2 and 0.4, and one is the star network. So what happens with other kinds of network types? Can you give a glimpse of what does 0.2 mean given this? Is it much, is it a little? Something to make let's say, qualitative idea of the strength of this.
Yeah, so you mean the decentralization, because 0.2, 0.4, I feel.
How large are them compared with networks that you may find in?
This is an interesting question. And actually, I have to be honest, I'm not aware of other results which are other results that are so deep, like this one for a financial system. For more traditional financial system, what is inspected is just the presence of a core. So if you want, traditional system are analyzed more from the perspective of the eigenvector centrality, more than other quantities. Mm-hmm. And in financial systems, you do find a core. I don't want to give the wrong numbers, but if I remember correctly, for some interbank networks, the core amounted 20-30% of the network.
Okay.
That's what I remember. But then I'm not aware of any other analysis that is extensive like this on traditional systems. So this is a suggestion to check for this value. What is sure from a statistical point of view is this is statistically significant.
Yeah.
This is significant.
Exactly. You're right. The other question that more or less sequential to the previous one is, now that you are talking about statistical significance, we are talking about comparisons, and comparisons lead X larger than Y. This is the typical thing I want to compare. And this is a very nice question that is, would you say that the Bitcoin Lightning Network is more centralized than the Bitcoin Transaction Network? Or is there a way of computing this? And I add something, taking into account the fact that they are vastly different in terms of size. How would you do that? Would you run this analysis? And which is your expectation regarding the result?
This is difficult to say unless you explicitly do the same analysis that we did on Bitcoin Lightning Network on the traditional one. This we haven't done. This is something we have to do, of course. This needs to be explored. In general, it's quite difficult to say that one is more centralized than the other. From a purely statistical point of view, what is meaningful is that it's more centralized than the expectation. Otherwise, you have to compare p-values, and that's become tricky.
Yeah.
So, I mean, there are statistical issues here.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, so mm-hmm. it's quite
you, a delicate. You need to understand from which ensemble the network was drawn in order to derive this kind of results, and this is the difficult part.
Yes, but the way to answer this question is to take the configuration model, apply it to the Bitcoin transaction network, so to the first layer, and check for the statistical significance of centrality. You can calculate a Z score, you mm-hmm. can calculate a P value, what you want.
Okay, good. A Florian that made the question can start preparing an abstract for a master thesis then. Yes. The other question that more or less was related to this is there a competition for the fees between the nodes? Is there in the Lightning Network? Thorsten asks whether there is competition for the fees, or how does the market work there with the fees? Do you know?
We suspect that some node actually wants to be central. So in this sense, there is a competition for the fees. So the user want to gain more. So they want to gain centrality from this point of view. As far as I understand, with that, I can say there is.
But yeah. Mm-hmm. I also have the same impression as well. I think that there is not actually a market mechanism to lower the fees, but it is the competition for centrality that drives your payoffs. And this is why it is, in a way, a strategic network formation game. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And the other question, the final question that I have in this Q&A chat is, can you please tell us a little bit about the role of the mining pools inside of the data sets that you have analyzed? Which role are they playing? Which locations do they have? Or do you suspect that they may have?
For the mining pool, maybe. What I can say is that, let's say that for the Bitcoin transaction network, maybe the notion of centrality, a similar notion of centrality can be recovered also for the mining pools. So someone can say that mining pools play a central role in the network. Now this is somehow hidden because everything that is done by them ends in the blockchain. So maybe the question is about a more direct relationship with between mining pools and address and users. That's a bit more difficult to answer, I believe. Mm-hmm.
And at the end of the day, what requires is a separate analysis in which they identify inside of these scales. So if I understand correctly, there are no other questions for the moment. So I would like to thank you, Tiziano, for this very interesting presentation.
Thank you very much.
To the people from the Centrum and Trust Square, organized so brilliantly this dual session that we had today, and to all of you for participating in this lecture today. Remember that we are going to have another one. There is a final question that I would like to ask by Jan. Can centralization give us a clue about the underlying mechanism that new nodes use to connect to the network? Uh-huh.
That's very interesting. That's very interesting. I would say yes, because recent results also from Claudio have shown that nodes that enter the system trying to maximizing their centrality actually have a consequence on the network in that they make the network more nested. If the question is there, the way nodes want to, the way nodes enter the system, of course, affect the topological properties of the system. Another kind aspect of the question is there a preferential attachment mechanism also for the Bitcoin Lightning Network? This may be plausible, but still needs to be verified. This may be plausible in the sense that there may be a generalized preferential attachment mechanism. So instead of attaching to the node with the largest degree, you may decide to attach to the node with any with the largest centrality, according to any definition of centrality. This is a kind of generalized preferential attachment that I believe is in line with the results, the last results by Claudio.
Yeah.
That if you do this, then you recover several of the mathematical relationship we recover, and you make the network also more nested, which is if you add another layer of structure.
Yeah.
So the answer is yes. Maybe a general preferential attachment mechanism can be at work.
Absolutely. So indeed, there is a very important, interesting set of mechanisms, but also there is a very interesting set of data that is around this blockchain-based system that allow us to understand them much better. So Tiziano, once again, thank you very much. Thank you to the people from Trust Square and the Centrum, and thank you to other people from the university that joined this meeting today, and to everybody. Okay, have a nice evening. Remember that we have a final one about a shadow central banking in mid-July. This will be the last lecture series from this eventful semester that we have. Have a nice afternoon, guys. Have a nice evening.
Bye. Thank you. Bye-bye.